Yeah. The enemy wants us to change it, to water it down, to make it attractive. Oh, it can't get any more attractive than the way it is. Oh, God, have mercy. The devil wants us to believe in this day and time. Praise God that a younger generation is coming up and that we've got to appeal to them. Well, I want to tell you, well, it appealed to me when I was 12 years old. It was very attractive. I went to a little sanctified church. They didn't have much shears, didn't have no carpet, didn't have no air conditioner. But when I heard the preach word, when I heard repent and be baptized for the remission of your sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, I said, whatever it takes, I want some of that. I said, don't alter it, don't put nothing on it, give me just the way it is. Have a little time. I was saved. We didn't have much. It was a little bit, but God was in it, and God saved me and brought me to a little high school called St. Jago High School. And those of you from Jamaica know St. Jago High School. Everybody that go there think they're all that bag of chips, praise God, and everybody just feel like, you know, you're all that, but God made sure that he saved me before I thought in this little mind that I was going to be the star out in the world. I come by to let somebody know that God said, the plans I have for you are plans of good and not of evil, to give you an unexpected end. So God drew me in at a tender age, and when I thought I would like things of the world, oh, God have mercy. And my mother said, I'm going to the United States, and I'm going to send for you. Oh, you can have a better life. Somebody not hearing me today. Ah, but my little grandmother said to me, I'm going to show you a better life. Somebody ought to put your hands together and give God a praise in this house. And so, praise God, the Lord made sure he saved me before I got here. Oh, you're not talking to me. Because if I had gotten here and saw all the glimmer of United States, I probably would have forgot. But I remember, praise God, when a little old deacon tarried with me until I received the gift of the Holy Ghost. Lord, help me in this house today. Oh, they prayed me through. They said, girl, you need the Holy Ghost. You can't live like that. Look at your neighbor and tell him, you can't live like that. You need the Holy Ghost. You need something, praise God, to tell you can't sin. Something to tell you, praise God, you've got to walk the straight and narrow. Something to tell you, praise God, no matter how blessed you are, there is still a God who sits high and looks low. Somebody give God praise in the house. And so, God saved me as a young age, brought me to the United States, praise God, and allowed me to experience a whole lot of stuff. But I keep looking back where I came from. I keep remembering, praise God, the humble beginning. I keep remembering, praise God, that as a matter of fact, that's what got me here. I'm not a fool. Praise God, that when God blesses me, I come to think I got it on my own. But I realize that now, praise God, I've got to be firm in God. I've got to take him at his word. So David said, some trust in chariots and some trust in horses. We will remember the name of the Lord our God. He said, they are brought down and fallen. We are risen. We'll stand upright. So here is Paul saying, you must be firm, fixed in the faith of the gospel, and then be fixed in your faith of the glorious resurrection of the dead. I don't know if there are any sick folk in the house, but I can tell you, praise God, a couple years ago I developed high blood pressure, and every now and then that thing just go way up, sometimes 200, over 100, and the devil would want me to think I'm going to die. Oh, but I let him know, praise God, if I die, this life, there is a better life.
Yes.
As a matter of fact, that's when life really starts.
Yes.
Because I don't have to worry about no bills. I don't have to worry about the mortgage. I don't have to worry about the car notes. I don't worry about the light. Because the Bible says God himself will be the light to guide me on my way. Peter, Paul, and Barnabas, they will all be in the city. But I want to see Jesus. Somebody say, I want to see Jesus. So we get all crazy and we get all bent out of shape. And the devil try to make us think that sometimes some things we go through, it's going to kill us. Ah, yes, that's going to just finish you. But I said, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all my fears are gone. Because I know who holds the future, then my life is worth living. Just because he lives. That's right, because he lives, then I can live also. So I declare in this house today, I shall not die, but I shall live and declare the works of the Lord. Do I have anybody here that want to testify? I'm not waiting for testimony service, but I'm going to testify anyway. You may not like it, but I'm going to testify anyway, because God has been good to me. You see, the problem with some of us, when we dress up, praise God, people look on the outside and see how nice you look, but they don't know the cost of the oil. Don't get the respect we're supposed to get is because we pretend. Oh God, have mercy. I notice in Pentecost a whole lot of pretenders, and some of us that fall would have been better off if somebody was truthful to us. Oh, I'm gonna preach up in here today. I get to understand, praise God. I tell my young people, I say, don't learn from experience, learn from somebody else's experience. Don't let it happen to you. All you got to do is see how that thing affected that person and tell yourself it's not going to happen. Oh, am I talking to somebody? I told the saint's mother the other day, I grew up, I saw my mother with six of us, praise God, and we got four different fathers. And I tell myself, girl, it ain't happening to you. I love them dearly, but I tell myself, I'm not going to follow that pattern. I'm not going to let no man do that to me. I'm not going to let him come, praise God, up in my face, give me some all kind of story, and then walk off and leave me. Oh, I wish I had a woman in the house. I wish I had a lady in the house that know what I'm talking about. Oh, somebody open up your mouth. And so, we go through all these things. And the enemy wants us to run away and retreat. But it's time to let the devil know you are here to stay. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby you cry, Abba Father. And he's no like the devil, praise God, to come deceptive and make you think that those who are born in a Christian home have more advantage over you. Oh, God have mercy. And anybody in here that has ever been to a church, praise God, where people make you feel less than who you are. Oh, but you've got to let them know, praise God, I was adopted. My name was changed. Praise God, let them know, praise God, that my daddy Jesus, he called me by name. That's why I can sing, I will not suffer. I will not beg for bread. The Lord is my provider. I will not beg for bread. He's my daddy, oh. Somebody look at your neighbor and tell him, he's my daddy. Like it or not, praise God. He's my daddy. His there are those of us like the prodigal son who have left home and come back, and the older brother wants you to feel like there's no room here for you. Make you feel, praise God, that you belong back out there. But I hear daddy say, come here, girl. Go bring, praise God, a nice robe. Put a ring on her finger. And as a matter of fact, let's throw a party and celebrate. I wish I had a backslider in here that know what I'm talking about. That sometime you come back to church and they make you feel, praise God, that you don't sit in. But I want you to stand your ground. Let them know on Christ the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. Come on, church, stand and receive. We gonna shout this one out of here. Because the devil wanna mess up apostolic church. But I wish I had somebody in here that would look at the neighbor and tell him, you better stand your ground. Feel like we've got to convert to the world. Oh, make us feel like we've got to change to what they think. But the devil is a liar. Apostolic church, we are going to stand upon apostolic principles. We are going to look like them. I remember when I just got saved in Jamaica and you walked on the street, you knew an apostolic woman. You never had to ask, praise God. She looked the part, she talked the talk, and she walked the walk. Look at the neighbor and tell him, ouch. Look at the neighbor, tell him, ouch. I never come to preach clothes. I don't come to tell you what to wear. I don't come to tell you what to put on. But I come to let you know that it's time we look alike. It's time we talk alike. It's time you look out for your brothers and sisters. It's time you declare, praise God, that we have a right to be where we are. And ain't no devil coming up in here to cause no mess. Ain't no devil coming up here to cause no division. That's why Paul wrote to the Corinthians. The Bible said he heard that there were divisions among them. And he partly believed it. So he came by to set some stuff straight. I wish I had a church, praise God, that would look at the neighbor and tell him, it's not happening up in here. You want. Oh, yes. Tell him huff and puff and try to blow this house down if you want. But I remember some praying mothers in the church. I don't see that anymore. All we want to do is dress up and look cute. But I remember when I had some women on their knees making sure that I live right, making sure that if I walk up in here and I got an issue, praise God, mama would call me in the back and say, girl, let me tell you, that ain't right. But this is how it ought to be. Look at the neighbor and tell him, we've got to get back to the old landmark. We've got to get back, praise God, where Jesus can say, ah, you've got my DNA. Look at your neighbor and tell him, I have a lawful right to stand my ground. The church must get to the place where we have a duty or a requirement to stand on the place where we have a right to be, or to give up the ground to an assailant. You need to let the devil know that you don't have a right to be here. Lord, have mercy. Say, I'm not about to retreat. It's you that are on territory that you're not supposed to be. I wish I had somebody, praise God, that would declare up in this house. Look at the neighbor, tell him, you're not backsliding, you're not getting weak, you're not going anywhere, but you're standing firm in the house of God. Look at the neighbor, tell him, under my dead body, you're not going anywhere, but you're pushing you around. Make sure that your faith is secure in the word of God. We must then be firm, strong, and confident in the faith. Be not shaken or agitated with strives and temptations and the cares of life. They will have a way, praise God, to pressure you and put stress upon you. That's what it did to me 2 years ago. Had a great job at the bank, 27 years, assistant vice president, doing well, so I thought. And that just slipped right under my feet. And the devil made me think, how am I going to pay for this nice house that God blessed me with? Well, I said, I'm going to stand on the word of God, because if God gave it to me, I ain't no devil going to take it away from me. Can I give my testimony up in here? Decided I'm gonna call the mortgage company. I tell myself, I ain't going through that mess that other people go through. I'm not paying no lawyer, and I'm not gonna stress over it. So I picked up the phone and I called the mortgage company and I said, look here, I lost my job and I'm making less than I used to make. I said, you gotta do something for me. The lady said, send me a hardship letter. Oh God, have mercy. I wish somebody would send God a hardship letter. Somebody would send God a hardship letter. You see, you're acting like, praise God, it's just simple and you're gonna make it through. Well, I don't care what your situation is, it's time you send God a hardship letter. Lord have mercy. Don't get dressed up cute ladies and walk up in church and have all these issues. So I write this letter, I pray over it, and I email it off to them. Quickly they got back to me and they said, well, we're gonna reduce your mortgage and we're gonna give you a 3-month trial. Well, after hearing everybody else's story, my heart started to keep a couple beat, pastor. And I said, well, maybe they give me 3 months, and after 3 months they take it back. But I look back at the word of God and I believe God and I took him at his word. And before I knew it, the lady called me one day and said, I have somebody that's coming to your house. They're going to sign some papers. I said, top. I saw him using this thing as, oh, you're not talking to me today. Oh, but I said, oh, what needless pain we bear. Oh, because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. And so this man showed up at my house, come with his stamp and everything, put out the paperwork, I signed, sent back, sealed, delivered, praise God, and sent it off to county to be recorded. Somebody ought to know today that God already recorded everything about you. Look at your neighbor and tell him, the devil want me to have disbelief, but I know what Jesus said. Oh, and I am standing on his word. Somebody open up your mouth and give God a praise. And let me tell you this. This process I'm telling you about, it started after Thanksgiving. And by May 1st, everything was signed, got my paperwork, and it was recorded. I stood my ground. I said, the word of God declare that he's my daddy and he's going to take care of me. So I declare, praise God, there is no reason for me to walk around stressed. No reason for me, praise God, to raise my blood pressure. But all it takes is a phone call. Some of us standing up in here today are afraid to open up our mouths, and that's why we don't get anything from God. And I heard Jesus said, you have not because you ask not. Somebody better start asking God. You better start telling God what you want from him. Can I give my testimony up in here? One time I was on the job and I went to church. Some of us don't listen to pastors. And my pastor said, some of you need to go into your boss and tell him you need a raise. Well, I said, if the man of God said it, I'm going to try it. So I went to work the morning. I put on my nice suit. I said, boss, I'd like to talk to you. He said, where? I said, in your office, and close the door. Lord have mercy. Because how many people know, praise God, that sometime when you go in to talk to God, you got to make sure you shut the door. And somebody said, well, why are you shutting the door? I'm shutting what needs to be in, and what needs to be out, I'm shutting it out. Because you ought to know that some people around you, they don't wish you any good. They don't want to see you succeed. So when they hear what your offer is, when they hear what your petition is, then they make havoc of it. So I shut the door, and I said, I was in church last night, just like that, and my pastor said, I need to ask for a raise. I stood on the word. I believe what the word said. And if the man of God that's over my life, if God give him a word for me, I will take it to the bank. I will deposit it. And I'm going to walk in faith. Praise God. Knowing that it may not happen today, but all I've got to do is wait upon God. For they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wing like an eagle. They shall walk and not be weary. They shall run and not faint. Be not shaken or agitated with the strifes and the temptation and with the cares of life. The cares of life can cause us to come in here and can't worship. The cares of life can cause us to come in here and can't give the praise that we're supposed to give. And the devil have a way of every time you get on your knees, he start reminding you of things. He start rolling back the curtains of memory and showing you where you came from. But you ought to let him know where you're going. Lord, help me in this house. And so today I'm saying to somebody, be fixed in the faith. Praise God, and not allow the enemy of your soul to seduce you from the faith of the gospel. The devil is always scheming against you, and he's very skillful. But I heard David said, if it was an enemy had done this, I could have borne it. But it was a familiar friend. Someone that I had sweet communion with. Someone, praise God, that I trusted. Someone that I believed in. But it's time you get to a place in your life where you realize that you can't trust nobody. All you gotta do is trust God. Because your dearest friend will fail you. But you gotta know in whom you have believed and be persuaded in your mind that he is able to keep you from falling and to present you flawless before the presence of his glory. Because you gotta understand that you're living among flesh and blood. And no matter how sanctified you are, there is somebody that's going to look at you and remember what they know about you. They're going to remember where you came from. They remember what your daddy did. Remember what your mama did. Well, it don't matter what they did. It's what God did. Somebody open up your mouth and give God praise. So the devil will befriend you to get close to you.
Yes.
And then zap you. But you must understand that it's easy for a friend to hurt you more than an enemy. Oh yes. And all this will discourage you from the work of God. But Paul declares you must always abound in the work of the Lord. In other words, always engage in doing the will of God, in promoting his glory and advancing the kingdom. Always doing that which is required of the Lord. So you must be like Mary and choose the better part. I love those women, praise God, that love the kitchen. But as much as I love to cook, I said, there's a better part. I said, there's a better part. And somebody's got to realize today that you've got to choose the better part. And so David said, the Lord then is my light and my salvation. He said, whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Church of the living God, the devil will cause you to run out of town. Make you think that what you did is so terrible that you can't show your face anymore. But you ought to stand up and show them, praise God, look what Jesus did when he washed me. I said, look what Jesus did when he washed me. When he washed me in the blood of the Lamb. So David went on to say, when the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. He said, though an ocean encamp against me, in my heart shall not fear, and though war should rise up against me, in this will I be confident. He said, one thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord. Not a neighbor, tell him I'm not a part-time Christian. Let him know I'm not a guest here. I'm not a visitor here. Temper, and behold the beauty of the Lord. Somebody open up your mouth today. to feel less than who you are, less than who God has called you to be. When Peter declared you a royal priesthood, you're a holy nation. I often tell saints, if Princess Diana only knew who she was and not get mingled up with people in the world. So sometimes some people wondering why you're not talking to them, why you're not friendly with them. But you better let them know I am royalty. I don't have nothing against you, but I am royalty. Unless you're part of my family, then you have no right up in my face. Unless you are baptized in the name of Jesus and filled with the Holy Ghost, it tells me we're not going the same place. You can be as cute as you want to be, but if you don't have on the name of Jesus, you and I are not going the same place. And every now and then, you've got to leave them by themselves. You've got to be like Jesus. The Bible said, as a boy, his parents went to pay taxes.
Yes.
On their way back home, they realized that he wasn't there anymore.
Yes.
The Bible said it took them 3 days journey to go back and find him. You've got to let some people look for you sometime. Can I talk to
you?
You can't be up in things all the time, but sometimes you've got to just exit. You've got to let people ask for you. Say, long time I haven't seen you. Brother Dave, I haven't seen you in a long time, but I'm glad to see you in the house of the Lord today. Somebody open up your mouth and tell the Lord thank you. Tell him thank you for keeping me. Thank you for preserving me. Because if it had not been for the Lord on my side, the devil would have swallowed me up. He would have minced me to pieces. But look at God. You're still here. You're still giving God praise. Somebody said I wouldn't make it. Somebody said I wouldn't be here today. Somebody said I wouldn't amount to anything. Oh, but you ought to look at the neighbor and tell him, divorce can't get me out of the church. Somebody leaving me can't get me out of the church. Losing a job can't get me out of the church. Breaking my heart won't get me out of the church. Losing my job won't get me out of the church. Look at the devil and tell him, I'm going to stand my ground. Ah, for Christ the solid walk I stand. Oh, my ground. It's sinking sand.
Never would have made it.
I was at a meeting last night, and the pastor shared this with us. And the Lord said, you've got to share it with the saints today. As we prepare to close, we want to make some declaration in this house. Because we're soldiers in the army of God. And some of you might have heard it before, but I'm going to confirm it in your spirit again. It says, I'm a soldier in the army of God. The Lord Jesus Christ is my commanding officer. The Holy Bible is my code of conduct. Faith and prayer are the words of are my weapon of warfare. I have been taught by the Holy Spirit, trained by experience, trained by adversity, and tested by fire. God have mercy. Some of us sitting up in here wishy-washy and making the devil, praise God, let us feel less than who we are. But you ought to tell him, I was trained by adversity. All those bad things that you put me through and make me think I was going to lose my mind. But look at me today, praise God. I'm still in my right mind. I know this is Sunday. I didn't put my hat on my foot. I didn't put my shoes on my head. Oh, I wish I had somebody in here this morning that know what I'm talking about. That I've been through so much, praise God. That you know, praise God, the devil that tricks you up. Praise God, I gotta share this testimony. Lord have mercy. It must be testimony time. I went through a situation, mother, that the devil made me feel like I was losing my mind. I went and lay under a tree in Plantation, in Jacaranda. You know it's a nice neighborhood, full of nice, white, sophisticated people. And the devil made me think I was losing my mind. I went and laid under a tree, and they called the cops on me. Ah, the cops said, well, let me see your ID. Do you live around here? And when I got to myself, I said, I'm a child of God. There is no reason for me to allow the devil, praise God, to mess up my mind like that. So I got up, shake myself off, and decide that I'm going to live for for God. I'm going to do what God called me to do. So somebody better declare in this house that I'm a soldier, praise God. And nobody's going to move me from my post. Lord, help me here. I'm enlisted for eternity. I will neither retire in this army at the rapture or die in this army. But I will not get out. I won't sell out. I won't be talked out. I won't be pushed out. I am a faithful warrior. I am reliable. I am capable. I am dependable. If my God needs me, I am there. If he needs me in Sunday school to teach the children, to work with the youth, to help the adults, or just sit and learn, he can use me because I am here. I am a soldier. I'm not a baby. I do not need to be pampered. I did not need to be petted. I do not need to be primed up. I don't need to be pumped up. I don't need to be picked up. I don't need to be picked up. Am I talking to a church this morning? I am a soldier. No one has to call me. No one has to remind me. No one has to write me. No one has to visit me. No one has to entice me. No one has to lure me. I am a soldier. I am not a wimp. I am in place. Saluting my king, obeying his orders, praising his name, and building his kingdom. No one has to send me flowers, send me gifts, send me food, send me candy, or give me handouts. I do not need to be cuddled, cradled, cared for, cuddled, or I am committed. I cannot have my feelings hurt, bad enough to turn me around. I cannot be discouraged, and I have enough to turn me aside. I cannot lose enough or cause me to quit. When Jesus called me in this army, I had nothing. If I end up with nothing, I will still come. I will come out even a winner. My God will supply all my needs according to his riches and glory. I am more than a conqueror. I will always triumph. For I can do all things through Christ who strengthened me. Devils cannot defeat me. People cannot disillusion me. Weather cannot weary me. Sickness cannot stop me. Battles cannot beat me up. Money cannot buy me. Governments cannot silence me. And hell cannot handle me. And then bring me back to rule over this world with him. I'm a soldier in the army, and I'm marching, claiming victory. I will not give up. I will not turn around. I wish I had somebody here today that would look at your neighbor and tell him, it's time to stand your ground. Don't let nobody push you around. Don't let nobody take step with you. Don't let nobody undermine you. Let them know that you are a child of God. You are ordained by the blood of Jesus. Shows up in your face, you ought to let him know, praise God, back up. Let him know he's got a backup like the Red Sea. For I heard the Bible said the children of Israel got to the Red Sea. On either side there were mountains. Behind them Pharaoh's host was coming. But I heard the voice from heaven said to Moses, what is that in your hand? Use it. Look at your neighbor, tell him, I'm going to use what I have. Look at somebody and tell him, use what you've got. Stop saying you don't have what it takes, but look at your neighbor and tell him, use what you've got. And here comes the devil, praise God. He think he got them good, so they got to Jericho. And when they got to Jericho, it was a different kind of battle. There was a wall that was around them. Is there anybody that got a wall around you today, make it seem like you can't get to the promised land? But I heard somebody said, we're going to march around this wall, and we're not going to say nothing. Say nothing. Every now and then you gotta be quiet. Yes. Be like Jesus. Yes. A lamb before the slaughter. He opened not his mouth. But here come the seven marks. When the Bible said they went around with a shout. Look at the neighbor, tell him it's time to shout. It's time to open up your mouth to shout. I'm gonna give you a minute in this house to open up your mouth, praise God, and let the devil hear you. Let him know that you are here. He's trying to lock up your mouth. He's trying to quiet you down. United States Army, if you go abroad to war, and even if you die, it is said we've got to bring your body back. But in the church, you don't even have to die and people forsake you. And the army says, no soldier is left behind. I want this church today to declare that nobody in this room will be left behind. And I'm no fool. There are levels in ministry. But I heard somebody said to Lot, I cannot do anything until you leave this place. It's time the church realized that God wants to take the church out of the world. But he cannot do so until we are all at the place, rapture ready. And so it becomes our responsibility to stand our ground. And the first step of order is to say, nobody in my church is going to be left behind. We've got to have trained people for every circumstance that faces the church. We've got to have trained people in the church to deal with every failure that comes, so that nobody is left behind. Get to it, son. Ladies who are mothers here today, you know what it is to push a child out. And when that child is placed in your arms, I want every woman in this room this morning to take somebody in your arm and hold them like your own. Comfort them in the Holy Ghost and let them know, I'm going to heaven, but not without you. I know you have some faults, but I'm going, but not without you. We've got to take this thing very serious. Be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. That your labor is not in vain. Somebody took the time with you. I took a leadership class at Nova University, and one thing they taught me, that nobody gets to where they are without somebody helping them. And how often we get to a place in God where we forget and we have no patience with the next person, while somebody helped you through your situation. But I'm going to open up this altar this morning, and I'm going to invite somebody to come, because I believe, praise God, that God is here to save somebody today. I believe that God is here to fill somebody with the Holy Ghost. I believe that God is here to deliver somebody and to let somebody know, praise God, that I'm going to stand my ground. I'm not going to sit back in the church with a good praise team a good pastor and people are not getting saved. I'm not going to allow people, praise God, to fall by the wayside and drift away. But I'm going to do something about it. I'm going to make a difference. I'm going to stand my ground. I'm going to guard the doors so that not every and anything can come through and eat up that God has placed in me. We've got to identify when things are not the way they're supposed to be and fix them quickly. Make sure we get back on track before somebody slips to the grave. Because after all, it could happen to any one of us. But when we've got good doorkeepers, good doorkeepers who are watching over our souls and standing your ground. I'm going to open up this altar right now. We've got pastors and leaders that are here that will pray with you, that will lead you to Christ, so that you can realize that you don't have to go through this by yourself, but you've got someone that's behind you. Won't you come and let us pray with you?